Hi, Marker Boy with you once again, out in the woods, on a beautiful November day. 20 years ago, when we first arrived in this spot, one of the first questions that most people would ask was, what do you do for water? Come along with me, and I'll show you our simple system that has worked so well all these years. Before we get started, how about if you subscribe to my channel either now or at the end, and leave a few comments. Now, in addition to people asking us what we're going to do for water, they would often say, so are you going to drill? And say, no, there's no ferry, there are no roads, we're off the grid, we cannot get equipment in here. Fortunately, we're in very hilly terrain, and we get lots of rainfall in the winter, and we can use both of those things to our advantage. Just about at the top of the hill now, and what you're about to see is about 300 square feet of metal roofing that drains into a 2,000 gallon plastic storage tank. This tank is about, it's exactly 2,000 US gallons. It's one of the larger plastic tanks that's easily available. And one sunny summer day, it took only about six friends and neighbors to help me roll it up the hill. Not too heavy. And it's been perfectly adequate for our family of four and frequent guests and visitors over during the summer. And for interest, I just keep a casual record of where things were on any given date. So for instance, October 10th, 2003, we had about two-thirds of a tank. Must have had some heavy rains early in the fall that year. But come January, this tank will be brim full. And just with this 300 square feet of collection here, I'm entirely confident that I could fill at least six of these tanks quite easily just from this one roof. The water comes out of the gutter and flows downhill in this 1.5 inch plastic pipe into my very fine mesh filtration system here. Now, there are lots of filter systems that will do a similar job. There's tons of them out there. There aren't as many of them available that will allow you to view the filter inside the bowl. Most of them are opaque plastic, and when you're done, or if you suspect there's a blockage, you have to disassemble the whole thing. Here, I can see through the clear bowl to the filter, which is inside. And if there's no need to clean it, there's no need to disassemble it. But once it's looking a bit black and scuzzy in there, then I can unscrew the bowl and clean it off and start over again. Also, in the bottom of the bowl, I place a puck, a chlorine puck, the type of thing that you would toss into a swimming pool purification system. And that shocks the water as it's going into the tank. So my theory, which I think has been proven correct over the years, is that you might as well scrub the water clean before it goes into the storage tank. And then it's much easier. There's less intervention required. We are very fortunate here to live in a temperate maritime climate, and the weather's pretty mild most winters. It's very wet, but mild. But if the Arctic air blows, we can have, unfortunately, a sustained period of hard freezing weather, maybe 10 degrees Celsius below freezing for a week or so at a time. In which case, if this bowl was full of water, it would freeze solid, it'd break the bowl, and there go any chance that I may have subsequent water collection if I'm not here, which is the case sometimes during the winter. So my simple solution, it subscribes to the KISS principle, keep it simple, stupid, is to just drill a little hole, right? You can see this twig sticking out of the bottom of the bowl. Drill a little hole in the bowl, and in months when I know it's not going to freeze, spring, summer, fall, I plug the hole with a little twig, as you can see here, and that stops any leakage. But in the winter time, my theory is that if it's raining, it's not freezing. That seems fairly simple. So if it's raining hard during the winter, which is usually the case, then it will this hole will drain the bowl before things start to freeze up. So this is my summer position with the hole plugged. This is my winter position with the hole unplugged. And it'll remain so until there's no more chance of freezing, at which time I'll plug it up again. At the base of the tank, we've got a 1-inch pipe exiting. We've got a shutoff valve. Right angles is closed, longitudinal is open. This vertical pipe here is a vent, so that when the valve is closed, which I will do for over the winter time, over the freezing period, and I want to drain the line, this vent makes sure that when I open the valve down below, that the whole pipe is drained of water. There's nothing remaining, there's no airlocks, no nothing. And that seems to have worked well over the years. Top of the tank, there's a what used to be called a manhole. I guess it's a person hole now, but very easy access. Some people like to climb inside and scrub the tank clean before the winter rains start. I've never subscribed to that theory because, as I previously mentioned, the water is scrubbed clean before it goes in. All I have done for 20 years is remove the lid once in a while, check that everything's okay inside. We don't have any frogs swimming around in there. Never happened. And I can pour in some chlorine to shock the water, to kill any bacteria that may be in there. And our family has drunk this water all these years. Never a problem. From here, the line is buried just a few inches below ground for mechanical and thermal protection. When my friendly helpers buried the line, in hindsight, it would have been a good idea if we had had the presence of mind to mark the general direction. Over the years, I felled trees on the line, punctured it once, and also I lit a fire that only later did I realize was probably a little bit too close. That would have been self-extinguishing, but not a good idea. So it's at this point where the line exits from the underground, such as it is, flows across the hard rock surface and then back underneath the cabin to the simple filtration system that we have set up. Back under the cabin, I don't like coming under here too often. Here's the incoming line, and the first stop here is a 1-inch shutoff valve, which is currently open, feeding the Rainfresh brand filter unit. It's just a single bowl with an activated charcoal filter installed. And the reason for the charcoal filter is that should there be any chlorine remaining in the water, the charcoal filter will filter out the chlorine. We wind it with a pretty pure glass of water upstairs. This line here bypasses the filtration unit and feeds a standpipe that I have. So down at the standpipe here, which is the lowest point of the systems, 100 feet above us is where the tank is located. And if I remember correctly, if you want to get technical, you're good for about 0.4 of a pound of pressure per vertical foot. So in theory, assuming I'm correct with my 100 feet, we've got about 40 pounds pressure here, which is entirely sufficient to push the water through the filter, to push it through the demand hot water tank. Just gotta show you the flow into a bucket here. There's a hole in my bucket. Dealiza, dealiza. Anyway, lots of water, good pressure. Nice and clean. I installed a demand, just a mini demand hot water heater to supply hot water to the sink. That way we don't have to boil our water to heat it up. And it's very nice, very convenient. And the price was right. So there we have it. Clean, potable, hot and cold, running water right at the sink. Crystal clear. And yummy.
Hey, thanks for watching once again. It's been a pleasure. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel, and that way you'll get notification next time I put up a new video. Thanks a lot. See you next time. There's a hole in my bucket, dear Liza, there's a hole in my bucket, dear Liza, a hole.